Brady has been to a really interesting historical site. It is the site of the first nuclear reactor designed to make plutonium. It started operation in 1943, in the middle of the Second World War. The reactor is still there, though it's no longer operating. I thought it was operating because there were three workers apparently working on it, but then I realized that they were just models. Brady thinks that's very funny.
Yeah, I do.
So we are at Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and this is the site of the world's first continuously operated reactor. You may recall that at Chicago, a pile of uranium and graphite led to the first measurement of criticality. What happened here was the design and construction of the first purpose-built reactor to run continuously. There were three paths to a nuclear weapon. One of them was involved the production of plutonium, which is an artificial element which must be produced in a nuclear reactor. This reactor was built to demonstrate that process. It was a project led by Fermi. The design was principally done by Eugene Wigner, who was a Nobel Prize winner, who led research of the lab for a number of years, and by Alvin Weinberg, who was the director of the lab for a number of years.
Exactly 3 days after Hiroshima, a B-29 set out for Nagasaki. At 10:58, the morning of August 9th, the bomb was exploded above the city, and in the towering mushroom, Japan could read its doom.
This is the face of the reactor. This is where the fuel rods would be inserted. After they were in the reactor for a sufficient length of time, they were then pushed out the other end. They dropped into a pool and were dragged underwater to a chemical plant where the plutonium was extracted. You can see the rod that's actually used to push the rod, but inside many of those holes would be an aluminum rod that has within it pellets of uranium.
As more and more rods go in, what are we getting closer to happening?
Well, you have neutrons flying around, and eventually what happens is that enough neutrons hit uranium fuel that you split enough atoms. Each atom you split releases two neutrons, and now you start getting multiplication. Criticality means actually getting to that point where the multiplication is enough to sustain the reaction.
When you kick them out the other side, though, it's not, you haven't now got a rod of pure plutonium.
No,
there's still work
no.
to be done.
You have a rod of a mixture of a lot of fission products, uranium that hasn't transformed, and so you have to chemically separate all that. And that is actually an art in itself. And that was done in a building adjacent to this.
Uranium has two isotopes, atoms with different numbers of neutrons in them. There's uranium-235, which is in quite small abundance, about 0.7%, and uranium-238, which is 99.3% abundant. And this reactor worked on the decay of the uranium-235, which generated the neutrons, which then bombarded the target.
This is your favorite room, isn't it?
Well, you know, I didn't control it. So this is the original control room. This is where the reactor was controlled from. This is obviously model number one of control rooms for reactors. And it looks, you know, similar to what subsequent reactors from that era would have looked. And so these various controls would tell you about power level and about radiation levels and the extent to which rods were inserted and things that relate to the operation of the systems like the cooling systems. This was leading to the production reactors, which were to be built and were built in Hanford, Washington for the actual production of kilogram quantities of plutonium.
Why is it called a graphite reactor? Because you've been talking to me about uranium and plutonium.
So the graphite is the moderator. And so what you have to do is, in the fission process, you get two neutrons off, but the energy is wrong. And the graphite is one of the means by which you can reduce the energy to the range where you maximize the cross-section for the next fission. So this is actually the original logbook from the day when the reactor first went critical. And Fermi was actually here, and he was called at 5 o'clock in the morning because the researchers knew it was going to go critical, and he came in and observed the first criticality of this reactor.
As a scientist yourself, he's probably kept a few logbooks. Do you look at that and feel a bit of excitement, or?
Well, you know, we all fill out logbooks, and we all have this hope that maybe our logbook someday would get this level of attention. So it's actually quite exciting to be here and see this. This is at the mid-plane of the reactor, and that means that the neutrons that are coming out from the reactor are going to come out horizontally, and this is where the first neutron scattering measurement was done. Now, to give a little background, we got three ways of looking at the nanoscale or atomic scale properties of materials. One is with the electron microscope, one is with X-rays, and one that is probably not as well known is with neutrons. And the neutrons associated with this reactor, which operates at thermal energies, these neutrons have wavelengths comparable to the distances between atoms and solids. So you actually can do diffraction experiments from solids, which leads to different information than you would get with X-rays. It leads to information on magnetism. It leads to information on the dynamics of the motions of the atoms. And the first neutron scattering experiments were done here. And that led to a Nobel Prize for Cliff Scholl, who developed neutron scattering in the 40s and 50s at this laboratory.
I kept on wondering why they still had this reactor there. My theory, I have no idea if it's right, is that the reactor is still so radioactive inside that it's easier to seal the outside and turn it into a museum than to work out how to decommission it before all the radioactivity inside has decayed away.
This is the birth of the nuclear era from the perspective of the scientific and technological application of neutrons. And that has had a very important part and is the reason that Oak Ridge National Laboratory exists today, because the fact that this reactor existed after the war and this capability existed, and it was important for isotopes, and it was important for neutron scattering, and it was important for materials irradiation and the development of nuclear power, is what led to the continuing of the scientific effort here for peaceful purposes. And that led to Oak Ridge National Laboratory. This is a special place.
Do you come in here often?
Not often, but often enough to get rejuvenated.